Hello everyone, in this lesson we're going to be dealing with intermolecular forces and we're going to take it a little bit further. So let's say we have this container filled with hydrochloric acid, so that's HCl. Now there are two sets of bonds and forces that we need to look at. Inside the individual molecules, there will be intramolecular bonds. And then in between the actual molecules, so here where I'm showing this in pink, those are going to be our intermolecular forces. They are not bonds. That's the very important part that you need to be understanding by now. We also said that ionic and metallic substances do not have intermolecular forces. The reason for that is that if you look at something that is ionic, for example sodium chloride, it bonds like this. It forms a big structure like this, which we call a crystal lattice. And so if you wanted to melt or boil this, you wouldn't have to separate individual particle or individual molecules from each other like we have over here. So you wouldn't be breaking these types of bonds or forces. You would physically have to separate each atom, and so you would have to go inside here and break those bonds. And then if we had to look at metallic bonding, it also sticks together like this. So you've got all these copper atoms, and then you've got all the electrons on the outside. And remember, we called those electrons the sea of delocalized electrons. And then the actual atoms, we called those the positive kernels. And so the point is that when you want to melt or boil ionic or metallic substances, you don't separate entire molecules from each other. You physically have to go and break each of these individual bonds. And those bonds are all going to be intramolecular. And they are extremely strong. And so ionic and metallic substances have very high boiling and melting points. And Kevin, how are we supposed to know if it's ionic or metallic? Good question. So remember in the last lesson we said that you need to look at two things. Okay, so number one, we need to look at this Na and the Cl. If we look on our periodic table, we can see that Na is here on the left, so that's a metal, and Cl is here on the right, that's a non-metal. Even better than that, we can look at the electronegativity numbers. So this is 0.9 for Na and 3, so 3 minus 0.9 is 2.1. Now here's where there's that slight gray area, because in the previous lesson I said that for it to be ionic, the difference should be bigger than 2.1, but yes, you can also include 2.1, okay? The main thing to realize is that you've got a metal and you've got a non-metal, and so when they go together, they will be ionic, not covalent. Then if we look at this substance at the bottom, all it is copper. And so copper, we know, is a metal. And so if you've only got copper, then that is just going to be a metal. And so how do we know that these are covalent? Well, lovely. So good question. So H is 2,1 and Cl is 3. Well, first of all, H is a non-metal and Cl is a non-metal. And we said that when you have two non-metals, that's covalent. Furthermore, if you look at the electronegativity difference, you've got 3 minus 2.1, which is 0.9. And we said that anything that is smaller than or equal to 2.1, if that difference is smaller than that, then it's going to be covalent. And so for 99% of covalent molecules, you don't break the actual bonds that are in between the atoms, you break the individual forces between the different molecules. So we will break or we'll overcome these intermolecular forces over here that we can see between the molecules, not the actual forces or the bonds that are inside. We're not going to break those. So when you want to boil something like this that is covalent and it only has intermolecular forces, the boiling point and the melting point is very low compared to something that is ionic or metallic. Because when you're boiling or melting something that is ionic or metallic, you're physically breaking the intramolecular bonds, Whereas when you're boiling something that is covalent and it has intermolecular forces like these ones, these are very weak compared to these types of bonds. And so you don't need a lot of energy to separate the two molecules. You don't need a lot of energy to overcome this force of attraction. Remember, those forces are very weak. They are just like a little magnetic force. They're not very strong. Your covalent bonds are the strongest. Now, what I mean by that is these bonds inside. Then it's your ionic. Then it's your metallic. Then, all the way down here, you've got your intermolecular forces. And there's different types of those, and that we're going to start looking at in the next lessons. But they are much weaker than any of these. And so that's all I'm going to mention for this lesson, but in the next lesson, we're going to start looking at the different types of intermolecular forces. We've now looked at the different types of intra, which is covalent, ionic, and metallic, but now we need to look at the different types of intermolecular forces. I hope you guys are understanding where we are so far. Thanks for watching.